excited to be back again in St. Paul's Church. I was here a few months ago in July. Didn't expect that I would come back so fast in October, but God planned it this way. I'm happy because I'm happy to be with my brother, Reverend Canon George Aipofu, who is the rector of this St. Paul's Church. Secondly, God has brought me back for a purpose and a reason. See, nobody shuts down their own hospital and neurosurgery center and comes off for 3 weeks. There is a reason behind it. And I'm happy that there is a reason we are together this morning. Tuesday morning service is called the healing service, where we all of us receive a healing of our body, mind, and soul. Why? Because Jesus, who is the healer, is here. The healing happens because of the presence of God. So whatever state of mind we are today, God has been speaking to us through the word, through songs, and he's going to touch you by his hand today. How many of you believe that Jesus is going to touch me by his hand?
Yes.
And he's going to heal me. I'm not going to go back the way I came. You cannot come to God's presence and go back the same way. You're going to go back rejoicing. You're going to go back different. I love the testimony and short prayers and all what happened here. One person got up and said, I'm so happy that I was awake this morning. We don't put any effort to get awake, right? Do we plan anything or do anything? It's an automatic thing. God wakes us up in the morning. Isn't that beautiful? Mm. That every morning he wakes us up. So, if we are up in the morning, that means we are waking up with God. God has woken up. And I'm glad he also noticed the birds which woke up in the morning. Some of us don't even notice the birds that we wake up. We notice only ourselves. So the whole creation wakes up in the morning. But the beauty of the morning is that except man, the rest of the creation starts singing. That also he noticed, that the birds were singing. We are unable to sing because we wake up and start thinking, what are the things we need to do? So many things to do. One more day, oh no. That's how we wake up. The birds wake up by saying, wow, one more day. What a day to praise God. What a day to rejoice. And I'm absolutely sure many of us have woken this morning saying, one more day to rejoice in God's presence. Because Tuesday is the only day that we have healing service. I wish all the days were Tuesdays in St. Paul's. Praise God. Amen. Imagine having every day as a Tuesday and having worship and prayer all the time. And when we come into God's presence, there is deliverance. Some of you are here for the first time. Some of you have met last time. How many of you saw me last time when I was here? I want to see your hands. Wow, only very few. That means I have to tell my testimony also. So, I was very excited last time when I was here because we could take a week of class on the Holy Spirit. If you really want to listen to that, it's all there in the YouTube. You just have to type George Kofur and you will get that 1 week's class that we took here in St. Paul Darien on the Holy Spirit. This morning God is going to speak to us. Whether we like it or not, whether we want it or not, whether we are sleepy or not, whether we are tired or not, whether we are prepared or not, God is going to speak to us.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So what a wonderful God. Shall we begin and we will look to the word we read today, Acts chapter 3. We'll continue to read very slowly. There are only 12 verses and I will speak from every verse. So we will read again that first verse. Anyone from among us can read that verse 1. Anybody who's got the Bible open, just read it loud for me.
One day Peter and John were going up to the temple.
One day Peter and John
going
up to the temple.
At the time of prayer.
At the time of prayer.
At 3 in the afternoon.
Yes, Peter and John knew at the time of prayer he should not be in front of the TV. Peter and John knew at the time of prayer shouldn't be wasting time outside. At the time of prayer where we should be? In the temple. The whole of Darien, Connecticut knows that Tuesday there is a healing service. But only few of you felt that you should be here in the temple of God. So Peter, if you want to have a miracle, if you want to have a surprise, if you want something unusual, prayer time, make sure that you are there. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah is free, not charged. So just feel free to say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And some of you have good body and good hand and heavy hand. Just lift it up and say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I love hallelujah because in heaven there is no neurosurgery. There's only hallelujah. And if you don't know how to say hallelujah here, you'll be suffocating there. Angels are worshipping God. And we are going to worship God there too. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I want the whole place to be resounding with the word worship and praise. I'm sure by the end of the sermon, you'll be clapping and rejoicing. You'll be transformed by the power of the Holy Ghost. So Peter and John was not loafing around, talking around, wasting their time around, chit-chatting and joking and drinking and boozing and drugging and all kinds of other stuff. But during the time of prayer, where were they? Where were they?
In the temple.
People really don't like going to the temple. Do people like going to the temple? If that was the thing, this was full. People like going to the cinema hall. You don't have to go and say, please come to cinema hall. Does anyone go and say like that? You are kindly invited for the next film. No. They'll be looking, which is the new one? Shall I go? But St. Paul says, do you look? What is the excitement next week coming? Shall I go? Am I ready to receive something from the temple of God? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Nobody needs to invite you saying, Burger King is open and the burger is ready. Morning you are saying, let me go and have a burger. Here Peter and John didn't have an invitation, did they?
No.
No, they decided that they should go to the temple of God. But there was a point of time they never went to the temple of God. Peter and John were busy on the seaside. Jesus saw them very busy. They had no money. They were working hard, day and night, trying to make wealth, make their living. Jesus said, no, you leave your net and boat and come after me. Today, if you tell any Peter and John, leave your net and boat and say, go and mind your business, man. I leave my net and boat, what will I do? I'm trying to look for a bigger net. My net is smaller. You are not ready to leave the net and boat. But this Peter and John was ready to leave the net and boat. And those days they never had much prayer and worship. All the time, work, 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 work. Somebody told me in the root word, the word for work and worship is same. It is right. Both are called avodah. Work and worship is same. But that does not mean that you substitute work with worship and worship with work. Work without worship is slavery. Worship without work is begging. So don't do both. You have to work as well as worship. And today is the time to worship. Don't think about your work, just worship. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Don't think I became a neurosurgeon by just worshiping. No, I worked hard. You can't become a neurosurgeon or a bodybuilder without doing your daily routine of work, hard work. So I'm sure you need to work. At the same time, be sure the time of worship, the time of service, the time of prayer, without invitation, you are ready to go to the temple.
That's right.
That's right, brother. So then, from next Tuesday onwards, you're not going to come alone, you're going to come with a big crowd to worship God. Amen. On Sundays, on Fridays, wherever there is a time of worship, without invitation, be ready to be there. So here, Peter and John, let's come back to that verse. Peter and John went to pray, right? Mm-hmm. Read that verse again. We can repeatedly read one verse, it doesn't matter. Read again that for me, please, anyone, quickly, quickly. Brad, yes, you are looking at it seriously.
Now Peter and John went up together to the temple at the hour of prayer.
Prayer. At the hour of prayer, they went up to the temple. Then what happened? The next is the interesting thing. Then what happened?
And a certain man lame from...
A certain man! Is the name written there? Who? He didn't have a name in the town. Did he have a name?
No.
He was just a certain man. But when the story of Lazarus was told, even though he was a beggar, his name was mentioned. And the rich man's name was not mentioned. A certain man. Many names are mentioned, many names are not mentioned. So this man didn't have a name, but he had some characteristics. Can you read that for me, please? A certain man
Lame from his
mother. Lame from birth. That is the designation he had. What is his designation?
Lame
from birth. A disability was his designation. Would you like to carry a designation of a disability? No! It hampers your insurance. It hampers your job. It hampers your future. It hampers your marriage. It hampers everything. Nobody wants a designation as your disability. But let me tell you, in the kingdom of God, your disability is God's opportunity.
Amen.
Your failure is where God is going to work. Where you're starting right now is where the miracle is going to happen. Don't think like an ordinary man. Think like how God wants you to think.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So this man didn't have a name. It was not Dr. So-and-so. It was not an advocate. But a certain man lame from birth. Some of you may have some disability in your life. May not be born into a rich family. May not have all the capacity and abilities have like others. Some kind of disability, struggling with life, lame from birth. That was how this man is introduced into this chapter. Lame from birth. I would never like that introduction. But I'll tell you my story soon. Lame from birth. Then what happened?
Lay
daily. Even if Peter and John didn't come, this man used to come. Isn't that interesting? It was not Sunday or Monday that this man came to church. This man came, the Bible says, every day. Can you imagine? He is more serious than anybody else. Is he serious or the people who are carrying him serious? Hello? He is very serious, because if he has to live, he has to get some money. And if the others who are carrying him also needs a commission. So they are also interested in carrying him every day. They must be saying at the end of the day, how much did you get, man? Give me, I brought you here. So there must be some kind of an agreement, some deal. And this man was carried every day, every single day. Carried where? To a place, what is called? What is that place?
Beautiful.
Beautiful! A lame man sitting under the board, which is called beautiful. Sometimes you can see a house named Bethel and you find a crook living inside. The Bethel is called the house of God, but the man lives inside, doesn't go to prayer, hasn't got Jesus in his heart. He's the biggest crook around the town. He's a businessman. He wants to make money somehow. But the house is called what?
Bethel.
So now the gate is called what?
Beautiful.
Beautiful. And the situation is what? Terrible. The church is called St. Paul. St. Paul means power. Whew. People used to be healed in the shadow of St. Paul. As people walk in, there should be healing. Hello?
Hallelujah.
The name is fantastic. Very interesting to have a good name. Name is beautiful. But I want you to check what is your situation this morning. The name may be beautiful, but are you beautiful? Are you strong? Are you filled with the Holy Spirit? Is there the joy of the Lord in your heart? Are you struggling within inside yourself? Are you excited about the day? Have you lost your enthusiasm? The beginning of the service, I saw my loving brother trying to somehow impart enthusiasm. Enthusiasm doesn't come from outside, it comes from inside. Motivation comes from inside. You know what enthusiasm is? If you don't know, I'll explain a little bit. In theos means God in you. In theos. So enthusiasm is only seen when you have God overflowing inside you. Especially if you want to do something good, you need to have enthusiasm. For doing something bad, you don't really need any enthusiasm. Even if you are sleepy, you are tired, immediately you want to do that. You may be saying, today I'm not going to go out at all, but something not good, let's do it, man, come on, we may not get a chance again, tomorrow we don't know. Eat and drink and be merry, tomorrow we may die. That kind of attitude, no, enthusiasm. To be there. So this man was carried there. He is lying under a beautiful name, but he is lame. And he had a job, a profession. What was that profession called? Begging. In some way or other, most of us have this in our habit. Really? We come to church and beg. Do we really? Salary is given when you have worked for it. Money without working for it is called what?
Charity.
Charity. And charity, when you get, you have to have your arms going up, and that's why it's called alms. So you don't work for the kingdom of God, but Sunday you want alms. Hello? You want God to open up his hand, but we never open our hands. We want God to open up his eyes, but we never look up to him. We want God to open up his heart, but we keep our hearts closed. So this morning, God wants you to open your heart.
Amen.
He wants you to open your eyes. He wants to open your hands. He wants you to open your life, that he may do a miracle in your life. Hallelujah! Woo! Hallelujah! Are you excited?
Yeah.
I'm excited. Come on, man. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! It's me, I told you. In back home, we have a big chain of shops which are called Big Bazaar. And there, if you go buy one shirt, you get one shirt free. It's called buy one, get one free. It's a scheme. Always they put it up. Buy one, get one free. Here we have buy one, get two free. I say one hallelujah, two hallelujah free. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah. The healing comes.
Yes.
That's the come time when the bondages go.
Hallelujah.
Here is a lame man sitting there having a wonderful business, a begging profession under the board which is written beautiful. Everything is not beautiful. There has to be a change in your lifestyle. It may look satisfactory. You may be happy at the end of the day. You may have enough and more to live, and you may even have a savings balance. But situation is not good. You need to change the way how you're looking at yourself. So what happened? Let's go ahead. Let me talk to the main part of the story. What happened? Shall we read again? Quickly, let's be on the story. Yes, Brad, you are.
Which is called beautiful to ask alms for those who entered the temple.
All those who are coming to the temple, he used to ask alms. That's a good place, better than railway station, because the people who are coming to the temple, if they don't give alms, they will feel guilty before going inside. And the train, at least railway station, you can act as if you're running fast and go off, right? So there's a better choice of place to be. So he had found a good place to be there, and he was begging with alms like this. And then what happened?
Seeing Peter and John.
Here comes Peter and John. Seeing Peter and John. Seeing two fishermen. Not businessmen, not doctors. Two fishermen, Peter and John. Two ordinary men. I'm absolutely sure that Peter and John didn't come with tie and shoes and coat, did they? No, they were ordinary people. I'm sure their dress must have been simple and ordinary. But still they expected something from Peter and John. We don't leave anyone, no? If we can get somebody something from anyone, it doesn't matter. Even if our buddy doesn't have any money, if you can squeeze him and get him the last dollar, well and good, it's coming to my pocket, man. Get it out of him. So he is ready to ask Peter and John, and he lifts his hand up, and then what happens?
Fixing his eyes on him with John, Peter.
He looks casually at this Peter and John. It's written, seeing Peter and John. It doesn't say fixing eyes on Peter and John. But seeing Peter and John, there's a difference between that. Let me explain. Listen very carefully. Beggars never fix their eyes on the people who are giving alms. Have you noticed? Because when they are asking for alms, they are looking for the next person who is coming around. So they never fix. Because they know that it may fall, it may not fall, doesn't matter. I need to find out where my hand can turn. Right? You get that point? So they were just seeing, this man was just seeing Peter and John, and then Peter and John was fixing their eyes. That's why we do fixing our eyes. I was very happy. He took 10-15 minutes to fix his eyes on each person by name. I would have never done that. That's a fantastic experience to be in the church, knowing each person straight at an eye. Yes. Peter and John was not looking at him, but what? Fixing their eyes on him. Now is the miracle. When God starts fixing his eyes on you, when a man of God starts fixing his eyes on you, I can assure you that day is the day of miracle for you. I believe that this morning is a day of miracle for you. You are not here by accident. This may be the first time you are coming here for worship. It doesn't matter. Jesus is going to do a miracle in your life.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Are you ready?
Hallelujah.
You must have just come in just like that. May not have expected anything. Oh, it's some other day. I heard the bird sing. I was alive this morning, so I got up fine. Now you're going to get more than the bird singing. That was just the beginning.
Amen.
Amen. Say two amens, man. Say hallelujah. Open your mouth wide and he will fill it.
Amen.
If you keep your mouth shut, you can't fill it.
Hallelujah.
Some people will never open their mouth. Open your mouth wide and then they'll say,
hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Anybody who has not said a hallelujah, for you, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Open your mouth wide and then
hallelujah.
He will fill it. In England, in Britain, there is a hymn that you sing for the praise of the Queen. And there is a principle behind it, that you have to open your mouth, the people, the uniformed guard which sings the praise of the Queen has to open their mouth 1 inch. So let St. Paul have 1 inch up now. Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! I want to hear the hallelujah from your belly!
Hallelujah!
Because of the living water is going to flow out from your belly. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
You have come to the right place. Don't think you are in the wrong place. You are here in the right place.
Hallelujah.
The place is beautiful. The place is a place of miracle.
Amen.
You may be most unexpected. You never expected this morning. But God is here.
Yes.
Jesus is here.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So this man is looking at Peter and John casually. But Peter and John decided to fix their eyes on him. Yes, anybody in competition with Brad for the verse? Quickly! I'm not going to give you much time. Loud voice and clear reading.
So he gave them his attention.
So then what happened?
He gave them his attention.
For the first time, a beggar giving attention. If he had given some attention when he was small, he would have gone up in life. Many places, children don't study because they have attention deficit syndrome. And the biggest attention deficit syndrome is inside the church. You come and sit with your body, but your mind is somewhere outside. Some of you have already started thinking of the lunch that is prepared. It's an ADHD, I call attention deficit syndrome. Hyperactivity. Wanting to jump out, move out. Food, food, food. Sleep, sleep, sleep. So, for the first time, this beggar started attending. So I want to ask seriously, since I came here in July and went back till October, how many of you have been seriously attending St. Paul's? You may be coming here, I don't care. Your body must be here, I don't give up anything about it. But are you attending? Attending to the voice of God? Attending to the sweet call of God? Attending to the word of God, attending to the presence of God, attending to the great thing that God is going to do in your life. This man, this beggar, started giving him his attention. Then what happened? Then the miracle is ready. You attend today? I'm sure your miracle is there. What happened next?
Expecting to receive something from them.
His expectation was what?
To receive something.
M-O-N-E-Y. What?
Money.
Money. What was his attention?
Money.
Money. Dollar. Everybody now wants what?
Money.
If I declare today that $10,000 are given on Tuesday morning service for anyone who comes.
The church will go bankrupt.
So if I declare like that, church will go bankrupt and the house will be full. You get my point? If you declare that there's going to be some monetary benefit, lots of people will come. But if I say that you are going to get the glory of God, the love of God, the peace of mind, the presence of God, really? Well, how does that help me? Does that really matter? Why should I have the glory of God? I have lived all these years without the glory. The glory was lost in the Garden of Eden. I was born as an ordinary carnal man. Brad asked the question, what is incarnate? God coming into the carnal flesh, incarnation, into carnality. God could never do that. God decided to come into flesh. We are carnal, we are born carnal. We need to become godly, divine. And that can happen only if Jesus is born in your heart.
Amen.
Let me ask you, I don't care whether you are a Christian, whether you are born in a Christian family, what is your name? It is immaterial for me. But let me ask you, are you born again? Does Jesus live in your heart?
Yes.
If you don't have that experience, make sure today you open your heart for Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Say, Jesus, I'm a sinner. I'm a wretched man. I'm lame. I'm a disaster. I'm a broken man. I've messed up with life. I'm fed up. I had enough.
Hallelujah.
But today I open my heart for you. You come into my heart. I want you, Jesus. I want you into my heart. I want you, Master. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let me tell you my short story. How many of you heard my testimony? Only one person. So I think I won't have much time. Maybe I'll ask for 10, 15 minutes extension. Okay, I'll tell you my testimony. I was born as a hydrocephalic baby. I don't know whether you know hydrocephalus. Hydro means water, cephalus means head. A boy with water inside head. To be living mentally, physically retarded. I was taken to the best center in India, Christian Medical College, Vellore, the state near my state. I was born in Kerala. This is in Tamil Nadu. The first neurosurgeon of our country, the father of modern neurosurgery in India, Dr. Jacob Chandi, looked at me and said, this boy will not live. Can you imagine? Somebody looks at you and say, he will not live. Mentally, physically retarded. Good for nothing. Fluid in the brain. Sometimes people may say that you're good for nothing. Hello?
Yeah.
Your friends may say you're good for nothing. Hey, have you heard this before?
Yeah.
And no point in working with him. He's not going to get right, man. Everything is over. People may say like that. So everybody said there's no hope in my life. But I was fearfully and wonderfully made.
Hallelujah.
That's what the psalmist says. Even though I had fluid in my brain, I was fearfully and wonderfully made. When the hospital rejected me, when the doctors rejected me, my parents knew Psalm 121, I will lift up my eyes unto the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the God who created heaven and earth. And they lifted their eyes into the hills, left me there with my grandmother, took a motorbike and went out with this Bible, saying that Jesus is alive. He is a healer. When their child is sick, they went declaring that he is a healer. You look at the circumstances, then you won't speak. Start declaring the word of God, the word of God is going to come right in your life.
Hallelujah.
And they declared faith. They said, Jesus is healer. The kingdom of God came down for me. God healed me.
Hallelujah.
Why am I running down around the world like this? Because I want to tell the world there is a God who can heal a hydrocephalic baby and make him into a neurosurgeon. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
There is a miracle waiting for you today. This morning, just receive it. Then what happened? Expecting some alms. Next verse. We'll quickly read and come to the message. Then what happened?
But Peter said, I have no silver and gold, but what I do have for you, in the name of Jesus Christ.
I just love that verse. I have no silver and gold. They had nothing to boast. We have no silver and gold. You may not have anything in your pocket. Doesn't matter. You have the most valuable thing in your hand. That is called the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. How many of you realize the name of Jesus is more powerful, more valuable, more precious, more honorable, most exciting thing that you can have? Peter and John said, I have no silver and gold. You may not have silver and gold this morning. I have no silver and gold. But we have something different. How many of you can say that with me? Lift your right hand and say, I don't have any silver and gold. I don't have silver and gold. But I have something else. What is that?
Jesus.
Name of Jesus. What?
Name
the name of Jesus. Today onwards, you are going to use this miracle chabi, miracle key. Something that you are struggling with, you say in the name of Jesus. You are going to get your miracle from now on. I am teaching you the secret of heaven this morning. The name of Jesus. The most powerful thing in your life. The most exciting thing in your life. The thing that transforms your life. The thing that makes difference in your life. The name of Jesus. Silver and gold have I none. But we have something. The name of Jesus. How many of you are excited about the name of Jesus? We have the name of Jesus. Silver and gold have I none. Peter and John didn't have silver and gold. Silver and gold have I none. Don't worry about your nothingness and brokenness and shatteredness and big zero. You may be a zero, but God is going to make you a hero.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Why? Because you have the name of Jesus. You have the name of Jesus. You have the Son of God living inside you. I have no silver and gold. Peter knew no silver and gold. This is the same Peter who was ashamed to speak about Christ in front of a lady, who was three times denying him. You have denied Jesus many times before. Never mind. Peter went through something in the previous chapter, which is called Pentecost. Transformation, power receiving, anointing. All you need is to transform a person is the anointing, the Holy Ghost. If you haven't received the Holy Ghost, receive it. Amen. The counselor, the paraclete, the advocate, yes. Who is going to empower you, transform you, use you. Wow, are you ready? God needs you for the kingdom of God. God needs you to help out many people in this country, USA. And I'm sure God is going to empower you. And I'm sure God is going to use every one of you. All you need to do is allow God to use. Silver and gold have I none, but I have something. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. With what confidence? The next action is surprising. I got shocked when I read the next verse. What does the next verse say?
And he took him by the
hand. Peter and John had never seen a miracle before. Can you imagine one of you going after this, seeing a lame man on the road, saying in the name of Jesus and grabbing my hand and seeing him jump up? Are you excited to do that?
Amen.
Do that, your miracle is going to come through your hand. The power is going to, he had never done a miracle before. This is the first time he's holding a beggar's hand and saying in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. You need to act, put your faith in action. Hold the hand of a weak man, a lame man, and hold him up.
Amen.
Yes, that's what we need to do. He held his hand, and then what happened? Read quickly for me.
And he took his, and
took
he
his hand?
His right hand.
Right hand.
And raised him up.
Raised him up, and then what happened?
Immediately his feet.
Immediately, you raise a lame man in the name of Jesus, immediately the miracle happens. How many of you are ready to have a miracle? How many of you want to be a miracle worker? A healer for the kingdom of God.
Yes.
Your life which has been broken, a disaster, a lame, a good for nothing, is going to be transformed into a miracle, Paul's life. Hallelujah, Peter's life. Ordinary fisherman turned out to be a miracle man. I'm sure God is going to use every one of you.
Yes,
lift your hand out to a lame person and say, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Immediately, not the second day, immediately, what happened?
Strength.
He started walking. And then what happened? That's the exciting thing. What happened?
And leaping up.
Leaping and dancing and praising God. Have you ever left in this place? We were trying to tell you, dance, clap your hands. Or clap your hands. So much of excitement and Shosha was done here in the beginning. And nobody was trying to move. I don't know why. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah.
Did this man need an orchestra, guitar, piano, saying leap and dance?
No.
No! A lame man healed knows how to leap and dance. Leaping and dancing, he went home to see his grandfather. Is that what is written?
He was praising God.
Praising God and went home, went to see his old buddy. Is it that?
No.
No, what does he say next verse? Leaping and dancing and praising God. What happened?
He walked
where?
The temple.
Into the temple. All these days he was outside the temple. The miracle of his life transformed into running into the temple. Woo! Into the temple. All these days he watched people going into the temple. But for the first time he went dancing into the temple. The first time he went leaping into the temple. God wants you to go leaping and dancing and praising God into the temple, rejoicing in the presence of God and glorifying his name. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah!
Did he think, what about my profession? What will happen to my begging mat? In the evening they will come to pick me up. What will everybody think? Did he think all this?
No!
He had no time. When you have a miracle, you want to run. When you have something exciting God doing in your life, you will never keep quiet. When you have a testimony, you want to praise God. May God transform you with testimonies and miracles, worshiping and praising and rejoicing, running into the temple. I'm going to close with the next two verses. Can we quickly read the next two verses?
And all the people saw him walking.
And all the people saw him walking were surprised. Now from today onwards, you are going to surprise people. Your family, your old friends, all your colleagues, they are going to be surprised. And then what happened? A big question came.
And, then, and recognized him as one,
yes,
as one who
sat there in there. Yes, next verse.
The temple and asking for alms.
And yes,
they
yes, yes.
With wonder and amazement.
They were amazed and wondering how God transformed this man. What's the next verse?
While he pointed Peter and John.
And they thought that Peter and John is a kind of person who can do this. They're looking at Peter and John, and Peter and John knows they have nothing else. So they are very plain. What did the Peter and John answer? That's the verse 12.
Oh, and when Peter saw it, he yes. addressed the people.
Yes.
Men of Israel.
Men of Israel, why are you looking?
Why do you wonder?
At me wondering. Every time I come here, you look at me wondering. Don't look at me wondering. I have nothing special. I have the Holy Spirit in me.
Mm.
I have a day of Pentecost in my life. Why are you looking at me? I am just the same as you are. It is not my power. It is not my education. It is not my strength. But it is the Holy Spirit. What did he explain?
As though by our own power.
It's not our own power.
We have made him walk.
Walk. It is the power of God. I'm going to close with the prayer that the power of God is going to make some of you walk. Leap and jump and praise and rejoice. Your worship is going to change. Your lifestyle is going to change. Your character is going to change. Your nature is going to change. And in the name of Jesus, you are going to be a blessing for this country.
Yes.
Can we all close our eyes for a word of prayer? Everyone with me, God has been speaking to you. Today is a day of miracle. Don't lose your opportunity. Will you say, Lord, touch my life. Touch my life. I open my heart to you. Come into my heart. Flood my soul with your spirit. The same way as you did with Peter and John. Give me the day of Pentecost. Anoint me. Anoint me. Use me for the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 I'm so glad that I'm back with you this morning. Give God a blessing. If Jesus has it, we'll see you here. Thank you.
Thank you.